Good morning, First Church, and happy Mother's Day. Please join in the call to worship. You are welcome to recite the words in bold type on the screen. From the beginning, all life has been connected. There is a holy thread that weaves our lives together. At times, we hide from this truth. Other times, it is hidden from us. It gets buried deep down beneath greed and isolation. It is forgotten when fear comes close. But there is a place where we find ourselves in each other, a place where every living thing is valued. We come to it on occasion, in brief and fleeting moments. It is our home in the life of God, our place of origin and return. Let us go there together. Love has shown us the way. Please join us in singing our gathering hymn. The words will appear on the screen in just a moment.
Oh, welcome the first church. We welcome those who are new to our community. This is a place to explore your spirituality and bring your questions. We don't have all the answers, but together we will ask the hard questions and confront the troubles and injustices we see in the world. With God's help, we will use our voices and energy to bring about change. I hope you take a moment to give us a shout out in the comments or send an email or just like us on Facebook or click subscribe on YouTube. If those words don't make any sense to you whatsoever, it doesn't matter. I'm just so glad you're here and present worshiping with us in this moment. Yesterday, an all-church email went out with two invitations. The first is to our end-of-year ministry celebration. The first week of June, both a live meeting on Wednesday night, which is an all-church conference, and a celebration and worship that first Sunday of June. I hope you put both Wednesday and Sunday on your calendars as we celebrate, in a new way, the joys and successes of the past year, and get ready for summer that will hopefully make all things new for us. The second is a document outlining how First Church is preparing for whatever is next. During this season of COVID-19 restrictions, we often feel like we're reacting to the public health guidance as it comes out and following along with our annual conference leadership. I believe we have done good, diligent work taking care of our people's physical and spiritual health. I believe that. But we are called to dream and envision the future, and your church leadership has released a plan and a process for how we will be the church in whatever phase of recovery the Seattle area is in. So you will have clarity, and there's transparency about our practices and expectations, and when things are going to be open and when things are going to be closed. I hope you'll read it on our website, and that you know that all of our steps are taken in consultation with public health and with our annual conference, United Methodist leadership. There are many ways to remain connected with each other in this season of being safe at home. First Church in many houses, I like to say. There are twice weekly devotionals. There are community circles that check in with each other on Fridays. There are Sunday and Monday classes and our weekly worship that we're in right now. I hope you take advantage of these. Put yourself out there just a little bit so that we can weather this season together. And now I invite you to center your heart for worship as we celebrate God who is with us, that we are never alone, that God is present even in the dark storms of life.
God will raise you.
Please join me in prayer. As we gather together online, we celebrate especially today all mothers who daily offer nurturance and love to their families, currently or in the past. We also recognize non-traditional families where a mother's love is provided by others in the family or in the community. Even though physically we are apart, we celebrate God's strength and healing in these times. As Christians, we recognize the power of prayer and faith in God to care for us, much like mothers care for their families. The circumstances regarding the coronavirus around the world have caused people to be afraid. Let us remember that God's Spirit is always with us, around us, and within us. We have the Holy Spirit to comfort us in our fear and loneliness. Together, we ask God to watch over those who are especially vulnerable at this time, such as healthcare workers, first responders, sanitation workers, displaced workers, and others who are especially endangered by the virus. We are grateful for their service and pray for their safety. Please also keep all our church members and community safe. We particularly send forward the prayer request of Kathy Perkins for her mother, Dorothy Michelson, a member of First Church. She's experiencing severe back pain that came on very suddenly. This is new and frightening for her as she is active and has never experienced pain like this. Please also remember Jane Hines, who asks for prayer. She is finding life under stay-at-home orders lonely and difficult. Please rejoice with us, Nikki and Warren Askoff, as we celebrate the birth of our great-granddaughter, Isabel Mackenzie Corrales, on April 30th. We are thankful for the opportunity to meet this newest family member by Zoom. Let each of us think of ways that we can share our love and compassion with those who are having an especially difficult time. We pray for those who are homeless and especially vulnerable. Although we are physically isolated, let's reach out to others by telephone, email, or social media. We need to stay connected to prevent social isolation of those who are already lonely and depressed, or those whose livelihood has been endangered. We pray that our new community circles will engage church members in meaningful relationships. With our church doors shut, it is now time for us to show that our church has never been about a building. Please guide us in how we may each demonstrate our love of God as we offer ourselves in your service. Amen. Please join us in singing the prayer response.
The scriptures are for today are from the New Testament book of Acts and the Old Testament Hebrew Bible book of Psalms. Psalms is a book of hymns and music from before Jesus, and Acts is a history book of the early church immediately after Jesus died and was resurrected. The story in Acts today tells the story of Stephen, an apostle, who was the first named martyr in Christianity, killed specifically for his faith in Jesus Christ and his unrepentant proclamation of his belief. Remember, in the early days, Christianity was a sect of Judaism, a segment of it. We know how we feel about smaller groups of Christians that seem to have things a little different than everyone else, skirting the edges of blasphemy. Maybe this church is even seen that way by some sections as we affirm the full inclusion of LGBTQIA+ persons. But regardless, what became a calling out of the majority to the minority and a heated debate rapidly became a murderous situation stoked by those who wanted Stephen dead. But in Stephen's heart, in his last moments, it is not fear or anger at his unjust treatment, but faith and confidence in God. That faith was shaped by his reading of Scripture throughout his life, including undoubtedly this psalm we read today. Psalms are hymns, and they are hymns of celebration and hymns of lament and all the emotions in between. This song is one of almost both. It laments the circumstances that a person is in, but yet it shares assurance, knowing that God is with them. They can be assured of God's presence amongst them. May this psalm be a hymn for you as well, knowing that whatever you're struggling with, God is present with you, a rock of refuge, resilient against the stormy sea. Thank you to the readers who guide us through today.
But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he died.
The Old Testament reading today is from Psalm 31, verses 1 through 5, 15 through 16. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. This is the word of life. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable not to each other, but to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Back in the 1990s, a story is told of a 42-year-old woman in Cleveland named Georgine Johnson. As she approached middle age, she took up running. She decided to enter a 10K race, figured that's about 6 miles. She can do that. It sounds like an eternity to me, but whatever, I affirm her. Now, on the day of the race, it seems she got there early, and she saw plenty of people there, stretching, loosening up, getting ready to run. She joins that crowd, and the race starts, pistol goes off, and they were gone. After 4 miles running with her closest best friends, she wondered when they were going to double back to the finish line. They kept going. As she gets closer to 6 miles, she stopped to ask an official and discovered that she was running in a marathon. 26.2 miles instead of 6. Her race was 15 minutes later that day, starting at the same line as the marathon. Now, I'd probably have quit right then, but Georgine didn't. She is quoted as saying that she saw someone's shirt that said, "Just do it." You know the company. Just do it. So she kept running, complaining the whole time to any official who she saw about the mix-up. Georgine Johnson finished in 4 hours, 4 minutes, good enough for 83rd place in the women's division. She said afterward, and this is the sermon in a sentence, "This isn't the race I entered. This isn't what I expected. But for better or worse, this is the race I'm in." Friends, we didn't know what race we were in during this season of COVID-19 lockdowns, did we? We didn't know this season of life was going to take place or that we would be swept into running it. Almost 2 months ago, when we went into the unknown, sheltering in place, safe at home, we thought it would be short. We thought it'd be a few weeks, let things get stabilized, people would behave, people would prioritize their health and their neighbor's health, and then we would be back. Life interrupted for sure, but not impacted. We started on a 6-mile run, grudgingly, and ended up in a 26.2-mile marathon, and we're not at the finish line yet. And along our race, if you've ever ran a race, the world starts to feel a little bit different. You pay more attention to what is at hand, the sweat on your legs, the rhythm of your breath, the t-shirt with the Nike logo in front of Georgine Johnson. Sure, you pay attention to where you are so you can look for the people cheering you on at particular points or just the next rest stop. But for the most part, your senses actually get more acute and they get smaller. Even if you started the marathon with something buzzing in your mind, by the end of it, you either worked it out on the pavement or you just let it sit by the side, trusting that when the finish line is ahead of you, running a race well will sustain you through it. Friends, I don't know about you, but when I look at the news, This race is really difficult. While we are on the marathon before us, it feels like the rest of the world is getting darker and more terrifying. A white woman named Georgine can run a race, but a black man can't go for a jog in Georgia without being lynched by two white men. We have voted by mail for decades in Washington, but other states continue to disenfranchise voters and make them risk their lives standing in line to vote, hoping that will make people of less privilege abstain from voting and thus uphold the established leaders. Mad men occupy the halls of power in several countries that are cruel to the marginalized and the underprivileged. And closer to home, not only do we have to worry about hornets, we also don't know what worship will look like when we return. With many prohibitions against practices that we hold tight and dear to our hearts, what will the church look like without these things? We don't know yet. We don't know. But as the world gets darker, there is some good news. And there are some veils falling off, and the lies that we told ourselves are being laid bare for better. Cities and metropolises have cleaner air than ever before, showing clearly the effect of climate change. We now know which jobs can be done as well from home. Not mine, but we are making do. And we now know which meetings could have easily been an email or a Slack. Spouses are becoming much more aware of what it takes to run a household, and we are getting to know our neighbors more deeply than just, hey, bud. So as we enter this season, this marathon that we're in is going to have some joys and some deep, deep concerns. But we can't get off it. It is the race before us, and we yearn for some sustenance for this journey that is far longer than we expected. During April and May, our sermon series is called No Turning Back. As we pivot, in a sense, from lamenting what we have lost to who we are going to be going forward. It isn't a right angle turn. It isn't a snap of the finger. Yes, we are moving forward, but it is a gradual process. Following the perhaps well-known trajectory of Dr. Kubler-Ross's extended grief model, the stages of grief, we started this series in a river in Egypt. We started in denial, saying that this could not possibly be happening. We could not possibly be shutting down everything, could we? Then we moved to anger, frustration at the world around us. Why is this happening? Last week, Thomas and I talked about depression and bargaining, how we make sense of the world around us with these new lenses of grief. Friends, we are in it, in the midst of all these feelings. But in the grieving process, we're stepping back for a moment to address a current reality, that no matter how much control or outlets we have, there are moments when our emotions boil over and when we just leak out. When we are hurting, sometimes we hurt people around us. So that's the stage of the journey that we're in today, to which we now turn. Dealing with the missteps, dealing with the times when it is all just too much for us. The days of frustration turn into weeks or months, and we have lost our usual release valves to relieve tension or at least distract us from things going on. And so it builds and builds and accumulates until we don't feel like ourselves anymore. When we are hurting, sometimes we hurt people. I remember when I was a middle school student, I was bullied in school, messed with in the hallways, beaten up after school. all those stereotypical things. I lived in fear of the bathroom, that's for sure. But it was not fun. But I remember a kid named Josh, who was smaller than me, and one day I gave in to peer pressure and I bullied him. And I'll never forget the look in his eye when someone who we thought was a fellow sufferer, that we were in this together, would turn and bully him too. We reconciled, but it was awful. An experience that I will never forget. We run into this similar thing with those experiencing homelessness and hunger in ministries like Shared Breakfast. In the made-for-TV version of Shared Breakfast, everyone is grateful and everyone is happy, and the pastor is about, you know, a little bit taller. But volunteers know that the made-for-TV version and the reality, there isn't always in sync. We have guests who are hurting and who hurt other guests and volunteers alike, verbally or rarely physically. We have strong safety protocols. Our volunteers go through de-escalation training regularly, but hurt people can hurt people. So maybe in this season that you've hurt someone, or you find yourself testy and frustrated. The person who you are locked down with, there's a barrier or a frigid wall. I get it. You're on a 26.2-mile marathon, after all, one you didn't sign up for, one you didn't expect to last as long as it has. And it makes sense that there'd be bad days and good days and really bad days. It doesn't excuse your actions if you hurt someone or yourself. But does help you make sense of why you did and what lengths you now need to go to heal, to ask forgiveness, and to make it right. In Scripture, we read about the stoning of Stephen, who was the first Christian martyr, meaning someone killed for their faith in Jesus Christ. Now, before this scene, there were those who wanted Stephen dead, had spread fake news among the people on Twitter, whipping them up into a frenzy that Stephen, saying that Stephen had spoken blasphemy. It poisoned the water, turned reasonable people into a mob that stormed the Capitol in Michigan or in Jerusalem. When the religious authorities accused him of blasphemy, Stephen did the same thing as Jesus on the Emmaus Road we examined a few weeks back. He told them their story. He went back through all of Jewish history, naming the ways how God's vision of life together would endure, and named the false prophets and killers of false teachers and killers of prophets who had tried and failed to stop this story. The scripture for today in Acts reads that the people became enraged and ground their teeth at Stephen. And that might have been it. But then in that moment, Stephen had a vision. He looked up and he saw Jesus in the clouds. He told the crowd that's what he saw. And that's what turned it. That turned from an academic argument, a form they understood with some parameters, even with people playing dirty tricks. It turned it in from an academic argument into a mystical vision that few people understand even today. They had two starkly different ways of experiencing the moment, and they both reacted out of that. Stephen reacted out of his wholeness and content, sure in his message and his faith and his hope that God was with him. And the people reacted out of their brokenness, out of their insecurity, stoning him to death. They both felt the stress of the situation, and the stress made one person stronger and more resolute, and the other felt themselves become more lost than before. That's a story we need to hear right now. A reminder that we have a choice, that we can become stronger in our faith, more assured in this time of trial, or we can let it break us. But even in the most broken of moments, surrounded by the most broken of people, hear the good news. God will speak to us. God will guide us from the clouds, or maybe through a neighbor or a friend, or a just-the-right-time phone call or Marco Polo video chat, or, sounds unlikely, even a Zoom call. God is there. As the special music went a few weeks ago, we are not alone. God is with us. As the gospel reminds us, and the psalm affirms, God is present alongside us, even when we are pressed against the wall. Whether we are being stoned, or we look down and the stone is in our own hand, God is with us. God is with us. God is with us. And all we are asked to do is to be present with God as well. I want to conclude with a story. In 1948, Alan Paton, a South African author and activist, wrote a novel called Cry, The Beloved Country, telling the allegorical story of a pastor, Stephen Kumalo, a black Anglican priest in Africa. I say allegorical because 1948 was the first year of apartheid, and we can see its lead-up and its origins clearly in the novel. At the end of the novel, the pastor's son is falsely arrested for murder, sentenced to death by a white judge. On the night before his son's execution, Pastor Kumalo holds vigil on a mountain where he gets on his knees and prays for all those whom he loves, especially his son, and for Africa, his beloved continent. He prays that God will save Africa, bring it a new dawn. You hear the echoes of Stephen Martyr's words here about praying for those around him? But then the pastor says this: when that dawn will come of our emancipation from the fear of bondage and the bondage of fear, that is a secret. Did you hear it? When? Not if. When that day comes is a secret, not if it will come, but when it will come. That it shall come is the rest of the story. We don't know when our day of emancipation will come. To be free of white supremacy in our country, to be free of xenophobia and fear of neighbors who are different, to be free of the coronavirus and its brutal toll on all that and who we hold dear. But we do know the dawn is coming. The marathon finish line will be in sight, and we will make it together, or we will lay the road so those who follow in our footsteps, they can make it. Our race is not in vain, and we do not have to give ourselves away in fear. And along the way, we are sustained by the stories told by Stephen, by Jesus, by our foremothers and forefathers before us, by our siblings in Christ alongside us, and the still small voice within us, within me and you, to guide us on the race before us. We didn't sign up for this race, but we're in it, and we're in it together. Glory be to God. Amen.
This week, Pastor Jeremy asked me to talk about the bargaining phase of grief. As I think about bargaining, the phrase that comes to mind is, if only. If only I had, if only I do. Because bargaining is so much about the past or the future, it can be helpful to take a moment to center yourself in the present. Take a moment to breathe deeply. Think about how you are physically feeling. Do you feel the pain in your shoulders, in your stomach, somewhere else in your body? Be in a space that brings you peace. Nature, a special room in your home. Tell God how you are feeling. Journal about how you feel in this moment. Talk to a friend. Be present in this moment and acknowledge what you are feeling for what it is.
Centering ourselves in the moment is not about pushing away the internal bargaining. It is about accepting the moment for what it is and allowing ourselves to be fully present with our grief. As we are present with our grief, God is also present with us. And in that moment, we become participants with God in the healing process. I'd like to share a poem with you by Reverend Steve Garnes Holmes. The poem is called When I Am Tired. O ceaseless God, sometimes I am tired. I get tired of serving when the need is so great. I grow weary of loving the dying, healing the shattered, rejoicing with the hopeless. I tire of caring for those who do not care and forgiving the unrepentant. I am spent, crying for justice to unhearing ears. I am not a strong horse, but only a little burro, God, and I can't carry the whole load. Beloved, you are smaller than that, a tiny blue butterfly in a blossoming tree. I do not ask you to transform the tree, only to do your work in the bloom where you find yourself. For there, in that labor, which is enough for one butterfly, the nectar of my delight revives you, and the whole tree rejoices.
Thank you.
Please join in the Lord's Prayer in whatever language you find comfortable, or join with me on the words on the screen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Please join in our closing hymn. The words will appear on the screen.
And now go forth and know the God who created you, Jesus who redeemed you, and the Spirit which sustained you is with you at every moment. And may that bring you peace, a peace that allows you to run the marathon that we are in, that allows you to endure all that is ahead of us, because God is with you at every step of the journey. And may that peace that you craft within yourself leak out on others and spread this gospel of peace and joy and love and justice to every person that you meet. And may it begin today with you. Go in peace. Amen.